This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Good morning to you. This is the Chad Holmes Show here on WXCO 98.9 FM and 1230 AM. My name is Bob Look. I'm sitting in for Chad as he's got his vacation week this week, and he'll be back come Monday. And we want to thank him for letting us have the opportunity to sit in the chair here and have some fun and spend a little time chatting with you folks. Our phone number here is 715-382-9297. And in hour number two here of the program, we say good morning to Ann Walsh, who's handling all the button pushing in the other room.
Good morning, Bob.
Thank you for being there, because without you, it'd be crash and burn. I haven't worked a board since 2017. So
you're very welcome. Always happy to help.
All this new stuff, I'm still catching up. Mm-hmm. Well, for the next hour, we're going to talk to an old friend of mine, and how we met is as good as a story as there is in the broadcast life here. But Clark Eckhoff is a gentleman that I got to know back in the late 90s. And eventually we just kind of hooked up and kind of been together off and on, you know, here and there. And the next thing you know, comes full circle, and I hear that this guy has become an assistant athletic director at the University of Wisconsin, Stephen Smith. Well, that's what it says on your card anyway.
Yep, exactly.
And a good morning to you, Clark.
Good morning, Bob. Great to be here.
Yeah, and we've done so many things together, but we'll get to most of them during this discussion. But how are you doing?
Doing well. Doing well.
This is a new is this kind of a new a challenge for you here, being helping out with the college athletic department?
Yeah, I think it's been kind of, obviously going back to my alma mater a long, long time ago, it's kind of come full circle to go back there. Sometimes it's hard to imagine being a student there during the Dick Bennett era, and then being back there now for the last 3 years in the athletic department and just seeing the advances. Like I said, never thought I'd be sitting behind a chair, mm-hmm. you know, instead of, you know, being a student. So it's like, it's gone full circle, and UW Stevens Point Athletics doing very, very well and adding sports, and unlike some of the other colleges in the state,
yeah.
UW Stevens Point's in a very nice position when it comes to enrollment and holding strong and growing.
Well, you had a little bit of a connection with the person who is the athletic director. You worked together in the past too, right?
Yeah, it was kind of a small world to say the least with Athletic Director Brad Duckworth, and many, 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 many years ago, yeah. As we sit here and talk, as we've known each other now, probably going on like 25, 26 years, Brad was an intern back with Woodchucks back in like 99, 2000.
Okay.
And then went on, got his master's degree, coached college basketball for over a decade, and then got into administration. And so he's even come back kind of full circle, ended up out in New York in the East Coast coaching women's college basketball. And he's originally from Nacita, so he's kind of back home too. So yeah. It's a great fit.
You never know. You never know as you go through life. Now you went to UW Stevens Point as a
right.
college student, right?
Right.
But you were heavily involved with the University of Wisconsin, Madison.
Yep.
Yeah. With their, especially their football program, right?
Yep. Yeah, it goes back. You know, I was fortunate enough to go back there and get my MBA back in 2000. And so kind of carry both of those. And that was kind of always a dream of mine to go to Madison, having a lot of family members and an uncle that played football down there. And so it's been, we go back to a lot of the great days when we were putting on Mendota Gridiron events for Badger football. And I know you even emceed some of those events.
Had a couple times.
Yeah. We had a lot of fun with Coach Alvarez coming up, and, you know, during the years, Brett Bielema. So it's that was a fun ride.
Yeah. So, okay, let's talk about what's at hand right now, because we can reminisce a little bit later on. But the University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point, has been involved with intercollegiate, you know, for many, many years. I mean, I've got good friends who played back in the 80s, you know, for their baseball team and, and things of that. Yeah. So today's, you know, 2024, there's a lot of things that go into running an athletic department, because a lot of people only think of football, basketball.
Right.
And then the other sports kind of fall in, and there's other sports that you say are part of the umbrella or under the umbrella of your coverage, and they all go, what? They do that?
Right, right.
So kind of give some people, you know, how large of a deal this all is.
Well, you look at, in the end of the day, we have 26 sports down there, you know, at UW-Stevens Point. We've added
26.
Yeah, added, you know, five new sports, like this fall, we, you know, started men's soccer, you know, and that's, you know, I can tell you, boy, I tell you, we had home men's soccer games where the bleachers were completely full with between 500 to 1,000 people, depending on how many people brought a lawn chair. And
sure.
So very popular. That kicked off very, very, you know, very well. You know, we added men's volleyball last year, women's lacrosse. So there's new sports being added, which I think the chancellors looked at it as a way of almost increasing enrollment by adding sports and bringing more students to campus.
Well, again, that's something that maybe the public don't comprehend, that the strength of a university or a college, you know, is dependent on people, first of all, attending
their
school. And there are some, you know, people especially still have athletic prowess. They may not be good enough to see that as being a way of making a life, but they still love the competition, and they always look for an outlet that maybe can couple the education and the physical, you know, challenge.
Yes,
make them work together.
Right, right. Yeah, it's been exciting. You know, we've, you know, last night, Pointer men's basketball, you know, the first home game of the year, and it's going to be an exciting year. I tell you, people that are, you know, living up in Marathon County, Wausau, come on down. Coach Kent Dernbach's come back, was an assistant coach under Bob Semlin when they won a national title in 2015. He went off, became a head coach at UW Lacrosse. Come full circle, he's come back. And I tell you, in a short, about 17, 18 months, he's completely rebuilt Pointer men's basketball to the point of the dynasty it used to be.
Yeah. What the reason why I have a really strong attachment to college sports, not in the major vein, but in the, you know, smaller divisions vein, was back in, you know, back in my work days in Port Washington. For some reason, my owner and general manager struck up a deal with Cardinal Stritch College up on the northern side of Milwaukee. Yeah. And here's this radio station in Port Washington. What Cardinal Stritch wanted to do was very much what you're talking about, offering some their athletic teams and their athletic department as a bonus to come attend school at Cardinal Stritch College.
Right.
And they used the little old radio station in Port Washington to broadcast some of their games.
Sure. Yeah.
And, you know, I'm saying to myself, well, who, how is this, you know, helping us, the radio station? Well, of course, the boss, you know, they had some agreement with some money. But that gave Cardinal Stritch an opportunity to sell advertising for their team, and they built an audience. So I was doing these games, and again, I was, you know, yeah, I saw some, I never paid attention to it, but, you know, the scoring, Cardinal Stritch was a run and gun. I mean, it was across the timeline, and they were letting it fly type of team. They would score, you know, in the hundreds in college. It was entertaining, and it was fun to do play-by-play for it. Now, this, you know, the UWSB has got a really good tradition on the basketball floor.
Huge.
And I've seen games there, and it's, and I keep telling folks, I think it's the most secretive, best money can buy entertainment for sports within this radius area.
Yeah, and I think the people, you know, if you come down there and look at it, there's probably four kids on that roster that were probably Division II or scholarship players that just kind of slipped through the cracks.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of happens where they probably just didn't get seen or scouted when they were junior or senior in high school. And, yeah, the talent level, like I said, when you look at Point last night, you can roll out 6'9", 6'10", and you've got a bunch of kids, you know, coming from all over to play hoops for to bring that tradition back again.
And also, I would think that, you know, players who maybe didn't get that opportunity in a D1 school or scholarship mm-hmm. opportunity, they're looking at this as, well, we'll show them. Mm-hmm. I'll come, you know, we'll show, you know, my ability in that. And the way things now are in college sports, where that portal program where you can make a move from here to here. The players are looking out for themselves to, you know, for a better opportunity.
Yeah, people probably wouldn't understand, but, you know, we also have, you know, diehard college fans. When you look at the transfer portal and name, image, likeness, you know, we're dealing with the same thing even at Division III level.
Sure.
And I can tell you, last year, there was kids, some really talented kids within the WEAC. There was multiple kids that left for Division I scholarships.
See?
Yep.
And that's one of those things that it's almost like a, you know, the feeder system, minor league system for Major League Baseball type of a setup.
Yep.
Yeah.
Anyway, exactly.
Again, reminding the folks, we're talking to Clark Eckhoff, who's the assistant athletic director at UW. It's hard for me to say that.
it's a mouthful.
Yeah, but with the UWSP, Stevens Point. Talk about the other teams and the other sports, because you mentioned before the multiple sports, and then kind of just give us a little bit of taste of some of the sports you oversee.
Yeah, you know, it runs the gamut. You know, we have, you know, almost 900 student athletes. And if you think about that.
That's just 900 student/athletes.
Right.
On campus.
And almost like you said, student first, athlete second. You could, you know, they're, you know, our student athletes are, you know, average GPA was almost 1/10 of a point higher than the regular student body.
Right.
That says a lot too with the coaches, hey, making sure the kids are going to class and doing the right things, because at the end of the day, the majority of these guys are, you know, they're going to go off into the real world as soon as their 4 years are over.
Well, that was the whole hook about getting, you know, into a college situation, getting a scholarship. Yeah, you're going to play for a school, but you're also building your education base for the many decades you have to go. All right.
Absolutely.
We're going to take a little break here and be back with more with Clark Eckhoff. Is you are listening to WXCO 98.9 FM, 1230 AM, and Bull Falls Radio, and we'll be back shortly.
You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
Chad Holmes Show continues here on WXCO as we're talking to Clark Eckhoff, University of Wisconsin, Stevens Point Athletic Director. See, when I do it that way, it sounds better. It's a little easier.
Bob, you're just a professional guy. You've got this down in your sleep.
Well, that's how I do show up for work most of the time, is sleep. Getting up, I had to kind of retool my, you know, after all those years doing morning radio.
Yeah.
I still get up at 3:20 in the morning. I wake up totally. And then I have to, you know, I'll usually listen to something on my phone or something just to kind of, and then about 15, 20 minutes, I'm back out and I can sleep like a regular, get up like a regular human being.
Nice.
So I had to retool it because I had to be responsible and show up here. Otherwise, Ian would be really upset.
Really upset. Yeah.
Don't want to upset the man who's pushing the buttons. Anyway, with the UWSP, and the various sports you guys are hanging out there, I was invited to come and do the public address announcing for the football team, and I just finished up my second year doing it, and I love it. I really do love it. Yeah. But I wanted to be honest with you folks. I says, I've been doing this thing down in Madison for quite a few years, and I, that's my first priority.
Absolutely.
And I didn't want to sit there and say, sure, I'll do it. But I was with reserve. I said, I don't want this to be I'll do one or two games and the heck with the rest of the schedule. I'm a firm believer that each sport has to have that voice or that,
the
thing
consistency,
that people,
the voice.
Yeah. And people exactly. Just know, when women's hockey in Madison started kicking in the gear, they were trying to get me to do women's hockey.
Okay.
And I did a couple of the games and I really enjoyed it, but I made the point to them first, I don't live in Madison. It's 150 miles. Right. Okay, that's number one. Number two, sometimes the women's game and the men's game, conflict.
Yep.
Because they'll be both hosting at the same time. And I says, but I really think it's important that you have your own voice for this to
individual sport.
And now you see how it's grown.
Yep.
Winning all those national championships, and now it's like one of the hardest tickets in Madison to get, even harder than basketball.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So,
and having been there, not enough. It's a great environment, LeBron, too.
LeBron Arena is a perfect place to sit because it's not a bad seat anywhere. It seats a little over 2,000. It's perfectly circling around the
great design.
The ring. It was their practice area, but they built it to be able to house women's hockey, and now it's getting to the point where women's hockey is knocking on the Kohl Center door. Maybe we could play a few games here.
They'd bring in, I bet you they'd probably draw 8,000-10,000 for a game.
They have set the national record of the biggest crowd for a women's hockey game. So, anyway, that's my deal.
People love a winner.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's that's easy sell, isn't it? Now, UWSB, you talked about, but now also the women's basketball team.
Right.
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 They started their season already?
They have, and then they'll have their first home game tomorrow night at 7 o'clock down in Berg Gym tomorrow night. So they'll have their first home game tomorrow evening. So it's a busy weekend. No rest for Eckhoff the next few days.
Yeah. Well, guess what? Mr. Eckhoff here has dropped off a flex ticket.
Flex ticket, yeah.
And what this means is admit one basically for any regular season home game of any sports at the campus, right?
Other than men's hockey.
Other than men's hockey.
Got to put that little disclaimer in
okay.
there.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Men's hockey, and I, like I said, I've grown up more traditionally with the basketball, football, baseball, but until I started working, when you were able to go to Willett Ice Arena, there's a lot of people that maybe in this area have gone down there, whether to watch Wausau East or Wausau West play down there.
Sure, DC Evers, sure.
Yeah, exactly. But that ice arena is jam packed for every Pointer men's home hockey game.
Yeah, I went to a game a few years back. I think it was like maybe 2016, 17, something like that. Went down to see because St. Olaf College was
sure.
And the former head coach of the Badgers was Mike Eaves was there coaching St. Olaf's, and of course I got to know Coach Eaves really well. So I went down for the game, and it was the highlight of the game is the end of the game, and I go to the side there, and I'm standing where the team's coming off, and Mike Eaves walking off the ice, and he just gives me that double look like, well, Bob, what are you doing here? I said, well, that's a lot closer for me being here.
Yeah.
Say exactly. Hi.
I didn't realize he dropped down to St. Olaf, huh?
Yeah. So, but anyway, we got these tickets here at the station. And what we're going to do is make it real simple for you. We're not going to do a call or this or that because I don't have the time to mess with this. After the show, and that if you want to just text us at our number, 715-382-9297. Again, that's 715-382-9297. Text us, request tickets. We'll give put a limit on it of four, right? So someone grabs the whole bunch. I don't know how I have it in my hand. But we'll wait till after the show. And after that, we'll keep track of those deals. And first come, first serve.
Sounds great.
Let them take care of it.
Beautiful.
Mm-hmm. No, none of this, trivia questions or junk like that.
Or call number 13, right? Yeah.
Just move along.
Yeah.
Here's the ticket. And you can use it for any other than
the men's hockey. Yep.
Men's hockey team is also off to a decent start, I understand.
Oh, they started the season preseason, ranked 6th in the country. Mm-hmm. And that's a program like you're aware of, too. They won a national title in 2019. And the thing that's mystifying to me a little bit is the amount of kids that are coming here. I think most people from central Wisconsin would probably be stunned to see that you get about 12 kids that are coming here from Vancouver, British Columbia, all the way over to Montreal.
Yeah.
And these kids are coming out of juniors leagues out of Canada and coming down here to now kind of, most of them are, trying to finish their college degree, or we have a lot of them that are coming down here getting their master's, in business administration.
Yeah, and finish out their education. And also if they have some college possibility, they might look at another option moving up the ladder. Up the ladder.
Yep.
We'll be back. We got to take a little information break here at the bottom of the hour. And then when we come back afterwards, we're going to talk a little bit more about, the road of Clark Eckhoff. Some of the winding roads that we've... Some that we joined together and others that we weren't.
Sure.
But we'll have a little fun in the next half hour. Stand by as you're listening to Chad Holmes Show on WXCO.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Chad Holmes Show here on Bull Falls Radio, WXCO. I'm Bob Look, sitting in for the vacationing Chad Holmes. He'll be back come Monday. We're talking to Clark Eckhoff, the athletic director, the assistant athletic director of the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point. But as we said in our preface of talking with Clark, but there's so much more. and I mean it in a good way, okay? Because you and I first met in 1998, I believe.
I think you're spot on.
Yeah, and the reason why I remember that is the only reason why I remember that is the fact that I came back here to Wausau in this area on April of 1998. I got called from the broadcast company here in town that their longtime morning man Howard Gernetzky had passed away because of cancer. And I had worked with Howard and Rosemary in Milwaukee back in the mid-80s and got to know them and everything. So when I came here to work, my first tour duty here to Wausau was in 1988 to program WDEZ. And all of a sudden, I'm about 2 weeks in town, all of a sudden I get this phone call. And the secretary says, this guy, kind of a low voice, that wants to talk to you. So I think he goes, are you following me? That's how Howard started the, Howie, how you doing? Oh, fine. I was really surprised to hear your voice. He invited to have me come over to have dinner with him and Rosemary. Nice. He was prince of a guy. And then when he passed away and I was out in Sioux Falls, South Dakota, I just wanted to send my condolences. And I just went through the company because I've lost track of my contact. And the next thing you know, they offered me to be the morning man on WSAU to take over for Howard Gernetzky. And that's why I came back here.
Well, that's a good gig for you.
Yeah, a good gig. And then one of the things I started looking around for was opportunities to kind of promote myself and the station by doing something that was in the community. Well, the Wausau Woodchucks were there, but they was owned by the league.
Right.
Was not owned by a local owner. So I showed up for an interview with the general manager. Hey, I've done public address announcing for a couple of teams you may recognize, Milwaukee Brewers. And so it was like, okay.
Qualified.
Yeah. So be there for the first game. And we were just making it up as we went there. I mean, script? What are those? You know, they'd hand me a handwritten thing, like this scribble I got in front of me.
You know, here's our four sponsors.
Just mention them at least three times in the game. Okay. But I did it and enjoyed it. And I happened to see a guy that I kind of looked out of place to me. And that was you.
Yeah, there was a lot of college a lot of youngsters, employees, and we probably stood out like a sore thumb. You're up there doing the PA, and I was kind of kicking tires, to be honest with you, looking, is this even viable? You know what I mean? And went out there, and was in 1998, I was taking and selling tickets at the old gate at Athletic Park in the front.
Yeah. And so I kept an eye. So I did the first year and did the second, and then all of a sudden, you're going to have a local owner. And you stepped forward and you bought the team.
Right.
And off went the fun.
Yeah, it's quite a ride. And I tell you, in some ways, Bob, I sit back and I've, you know, just so many fond memories of Athletic Park and the people. And it became more like almost like a family.
Yeah.
With, you know, people and you and Jesse Boulder, who...
Oh, yes, Jesse.
Jesse was interning from Notre Dame, who was originally from Merrill, and he was working out there. And, you know, him and I have known each other, same thing,
met
in 1998, and we've stayed friends to this day. And goes back to the first real head coach that I had, Rob Smith.
Yeah.
And Rob's now, I don't know, he's semi-retired, living out in Scottsdale, Arizona. We still talk, and... But it was like to see where we took that in 19, being out there in 1998 and then see in 1999 and to watch the growth that happened out at Athletic Park, you know, with, you know, some assistance and great relationship at the time with Mayor Lawrence.
Yes.
You know, especially getting some new bleachers and some stuff. And
because Athletic, you know, again, this is going to be some of the people who are of a certain age probably don't know that Athletic Park quite literally was on its last legs.
Yeah, there wasn't much, you know, and like I said, you couldn't have supported it just with how small the crowds were in 98 and before.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But you took over as local ownership. In fact, we even came up with the idea of broadcasting Northwoods League baseball games, which is a commitment because they play, you know, like a regular major league schedule of games.
You're playing almost every day?
And in 2000, we just did the home games, more of an opportunity to promote the team. And also get the players known in the community.
Absolutely.
And so that was our aim back then, with a possible look at doing all the games on local radio, which we did in 2021.
Yep.
Which just happened to be the championship season, first championship season, which, as far as I'm concerned, I did that only because when I say I'm going to be there to do something, I do it. During that situation, the station ended up taking me off the air on a full-time basis, put me on a part-time deal, which is not advantageous to somebody who's
financially
to live.
Right.
But if I gave my word to do something and to do the games, I wasn't about to pull out and leave you hanging high and dry. I believe in the professionalism, and and if you say you're going to be there, you be there.
Keep your word, baby.
So I stayed with it, but my wife was all for it because she knew that I enjoyed what we were doing, and I thought it went well because there's a lot of people who learned, like the gentleman down in Madison who owned the Madison.
Yeah, Steve Schmidt.
Yeah, Steve Schmidt. I remember him coming into the press box asking me questions. Oh, you do this, and he was, kind of, I was just talking, and he was obviously searching to think, how is this going to work in his situation?
Absolutely.
And it,
I think within a year or two, he had a deal with one of the ESPN or sports stations in AM Madison. Yeah, exactly.
And so anyway, that's how that all that stuff kind of just grew, because we took baby steps, but realistic steps.
Yep.
Didn't come out there thinking, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, and never really think how you're going to do it.
Yeah, I tell you, he could write a book on some of the stories with some of the promotions and some of the crazy stuff you did. We talked earlier offline, you know, about Mike Vec, and, you know, who was very famous with the St. Paul Saints and the Sioux Falls Canaries that we were out there.
And I worked for them for a while when I was out there in 96, 97.
Just trying to bring some, like every night, different theme night, and whether it was a bobblehead of Woody Woodchuck or a fireworks show or... Though I remember the one time we brought a Harry Carey impersonator up.
Yes, yes.
And he literally, we had to go get him from Lopnow's bar because he was late for his gig, and he showed up. He was trying to be Harry Carey because he was three sheets to the wind.
Yeah.
So there were certain things you could write
a book
on. Not
only did he imitate Harry Carey, he lived like Harry Carey.
He lived like Harry Carey. There's stuff like that, too, I remember. You know, one
he was up in a press box with me doing, you know, and so it was like the fourth inning or whatever. So they brought him up there to come up there and do some play by play on the radio. And I'm sitting there like, oh boy, I hope this guy, because I could, the aroma kind of followed him.
Absolutely.
But he, you know, he's doing the play by play, and all of a sudden in the middle, hey, the pitch of balls outside for ball one. I'm here with Bob Look. Hey. You know, and you say his name or spell his name backwards, this cool Bob. Ah! And from then on, the team, that's all they called me.
Cool Bob.
Hey, cool Bob.
Yeah. Yeah, that was pretty, you know, going back to that 2001, which was, you'd end up winning a Northwoods League championship. And that was just a great memory. And like I said, there was, you know, we had a couple of local players back in the day.
Yeah.
On that team.
Oh, Danny Augustine and Aaron Bouchon.
And now Aaron's a dentist in town, and Dan's a wealth management guy for at an incredible bank. And like I said, that was it was always a double-edged sword, but you love to have some local kids on that team. And well, that both was, of those guys could compete.
Yeah, and they were good ball players. And I always talked to Dan before, and I says, the one thing about Dan Augustine, he wasn't going to, like, dazzle you. But if there was late in the game, if there needed to be a ball put in play or a hit, he'd get it.
Yep.
He figured out a way to get it. And it was such a great year, because halfway through the season, the team did not look like it was going to be
a championship.
A championship. No, not at all.
Right.
But we had a whole bunch of kids who were coming off injuries who were starting to get going. And I remember walking through a parking lot. I'm trying to think of the town in Minnesota, and half dozen of the players were just walking through parking lot, and we're right at the lowest end, worst record. And I says, you know, as far as I'm concerned, I'm looking at the talent on this team, and I see no reason why we can't win this whole thing.
Sure.
And everyone looked at me like I was from Mars. And Chris Regas, who was part of Tim McNabb, and others, they all just kind of, you're right, damn it. We're a damn good team. And it was like it just started building.
Right.
And then in the second half, you know, won that, and, well, the rest is history.
Yeah, you can see where in the Northwoods League, you know, it's almost like you have multiple seasons. You know what I mean? With the you have
split.
So many kids that might be playing in the College World Series. They might get here late in the June. So you're maybe using some temporary kids on 10-day contracts, and then you get those kids in. And then, unfortunately, you get to July, and some of the kids have to leave
they
to
get back.
Get
early.
Yeah. So I kind of one thing that we learned was the West Coast kids didn't have to report back to school till like, September.
Right.
So, when
Aaron
Fawcett, Oregon State. You had Tony Shuler from Riverside, California. Those kids, you had them all the way through. You didn't have to worry about it. Plus, having the guys like Augie and Bouchon, they were here. You know what I mean? So... that was a really fun team. You know, I know Rob talks about just, you know, the chemistry. That team was so different because of the chemistry. You talk about sports. I don't care whether you're talking about the Packers or Badger football. You know, you better be able, you know, the chemistry of a team, whether it's in the locker room or on the field, it's critical.
Yeah, yeah. And even at the worst part of the season, again, I was on all the bus rides. I was doing home and away games. So I got to know these guys very well. And you just knew, you know, that they gave a damn.
Yeah.
And the one thing that I always like to point out, they won the championship and the team had only one All-Star.
Tommy Oldham?
Tommy Oldham, the pitcher, who came in, who did not have a relief appearance all year long, but the championship game, when it was split one apiece for the championship, best two out of three, and our relief pitcher, Tim McNabb, that we leaned on, his arm was hanging. It was tired. Whole season worth of pitching, which is a lot more than what they do in the college ranks normally.
Right.
And Tom Oldham basically... He didn't, like, volunteer. He told the manager, Rob Smith, says, I'm going in the ninth inning.
I'm closing this baby out. And I remember, because I know Rob, you talk about, like, Tim, his arm was dragging.
Yeah.
And then I think Smith would have probably went to Casey Jansen.
Yeah, Casey Jansen.
Who stud played in the big leagues. Yeah. At least does, what, probably 6 to 8 years, I think, spent in the big leagues.
Good relief pitcher.
Yeah, and he was going to bring him in. And instead, Oldham's like, that mound in the bottom of ninth is mine.
Yeah, you know that's all he said.
Yeah, and it was kind of funny because I think even Rob looked over and, you know, as we got done batting the top of the ninth, and here comes Oldham sprinting out of the bullpen.
He's ready to go. Seven pitches, and it was a Northwoods League championship for the Wausau, well, at that time, Wisconsin Woodchucks.
Yep.
A lot of people always wonder why you call it Wisconsin, because they didn't have any team, really, in the state other than the Woodchucks. We'll come back with our final segment coming up here after this little message or two as you're listening to Bull Falls Radio, WXCO.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Welcome back here for our final segment here on Bull Falls Radio, WXCO, with Clark Eckhoff, the assistant athletic director at UWSB. And we were kind of reminiscing about our escapades with the Woodchucks. Hey, how long did you hang on to the Woodchucks before you sold?
Till 2012.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, this was...
I did have a return engagement doing some games there for a while, and Jimmy Gantner, the former Brewer, was managing the team.
That was a fun couple years with Gumby, or Jim Gantner, affectionately known as Gumby, because, like I said, it was neat because we had an opportunity, Bob, to, you know, Robin Yount came up and did a promotional night.
Raleigh Fingers,
and, of course, Gorman Thomas was up here for a few times. But I think one of the greatest was having Yount out there. And, like, Robin never played, you know, when it was the Beloit Brewers, right? Like Molitor and a lot of those guys had came through here and had played at Athletic Park. Well, Robin got, you know, he didn't spend any time, I think.
It was maybe a month of, like, winter ball.
But he never played here, so he always had heard the stories from those guys and stuff like that. But, yeah, that was a phenomenal day when there was right around 4,100 people. People were lined up around the block, two blocks, to get in to see Robin.
Back when you got Jim Gantner as the manager, and I was back in town here working, and talked me into doing home games.
Yeah,
help out on the broadcast. So they wanted me to do the interview with Jim Gantner, doing the pregame, and it was really really kind of funny because it was like I've talked to him before and that, but that was back. with the Brewers in the early 80s. So here it is, you know, 2008. So I'm talking, you know, so I'm doing the very first pregame show, and he's just staring at me,
trying to figure out,
you know, because I'm actually asking him questions, you know, that were kind of legitimate baseball questions. And all of a sudden we finish the interview and he goes, "Do I know you?" I go, "Yeah, I used to be part of the group of beat writers and that. They would be standing there in the locker room at County Stadium shoving microphones in your face." I go to tour. "How in the heck are you?" And it struck off a great rapport. And in fact, he got thrown out of a game. He was really frustrated one game, and he got tossed early, like about third and fourth inning. So he's back in the clubhouse, and he's listening to the broadcast of the game. So the next day on the pregame interview, he goes, "Hey, you're really good. I enjoyed the game. I think I'm going to get thrown out of the games more often."
You know, Jimmy, for the years he spent in the big leagues and the coaches that I've dealt with, whether it's the Woodchucks or even at, you know, now, it's like Jimmy was a guy that was could have had a big ego attitude.
Oh, yeah, coming here.
And he was, to me, Eden, Wisconsin, played at UW Oshkosh, another kid that got missed and ended up, you know, in the state and university conference at the time, what it was. And he was, for those 2 years, it was very enjoyable. And the other thing about Jim, he would never brag or talk about this or this or this. And once in a while, maybe, hey, we're at lunch and I had him out, and then I had the opportunity, maybe one-on-one, and start asking him, like, "What was it like to play at Yankee Stadium?" And then he'd start talking about meeting George Steinbrenner, or Reggie Jackson tried to sell him an antique car, you know, one time. And he was
great with stories. I kind of really pulled his pants down one time, figuratively speaking, because I did the Wausau Timbers games, you know, some of the final games of its existence. And one of the games had the Brewers, the Beloit Brewers in town. And Jim Gantner was doing rehab for a knee surgery. Okay. So he was playing second base for the Beloit Brewers. And anyway, so I've got the tapes of that stuff.
Wow.
And so here I got a tape, and then, hey guys, I got a tape of when Jim Gantner played ball here at Athletic Park, and it has him hitting into a double play.
Oh, nice.
And another one where he's trying to steal second, and he's thrown out. And Gantner's sitting there, and he's, "Okay, enough, Bob. You don't have to hit." I just did that to, you know.
Yeah.
I tease him a bit.
It's funny when you say him trying to steal second base. That's one thing I don't see him trying to run very well.
But he was down in single A working out, trying to make sure that the leg works. In fact, Juan Nieves was with the team at that time also, trying to make a comeback after.
Wasn't he the first no-hitter in Brewer history?
Yep.
And Robin Yount made a catch in right center.
Yep. Diving catch to finalize it.
Yep.
But, see, I'm Athletic Park and myself, I feel that a kinship, but, you know, it's like it's changed around. And to a good thing.
Yeah, I give current owner Mark McDonald what Mark, the commitment he's made to that, you know, that facility. That facility is it's professional, minor league quality. If it's phenomenal what he's done. And, you know, Mark will leave an asset back to this community that they could build a statue of him, as far as I'm concerned, for what he's done in the investment.
Yeah, you're talking about future. What do you see for yourself? How far do you even look?
I don't know.
Day by day, okay?
Yeah. It's, like I said, this is just kind of an enjoyable little, career challenge. And I think everything in life sometimes, it's like you said, you still got to have something that makes you want to get up in the morning and go to work. And so this is it's a fun gig, and like I said, I appreciate having the opportunity to come on here today, Bob.
Well, good luck to you and the Pointers and all the athletic endeavors. We'll keep in touch. And as long as I'm going to be here, we're going to be filtering in a few Pointer scores and that updates as we do that, and we'll keep folks. And that ticket deal, we'll remind folks
Throughout
the rest of the week.
Happy to do it.
Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Bob. Appreciate it.
We'll be back tomorrow morning.
Happy Thursday, everybody. Have a great day.
Ian, thanks for your help, and take care, and we'll chat with you tomorrow morning.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.